Hello, welcome back to our lectures. Today we'll be talking about the second part of the metabolism of nitrogen. Basically, what we'll be looking at today is we'll start with looking at the essential amino acids, those amino acids that cannot be synthesized in the humans that we need to get dietarily. And then we'll finish it with the catabolism of nitrogen, which has a very close link with what we talked about the metabolism, particularly the transamination and the deamination. We're not going to be going into details of those again, but we're going to be introducing a new dynamics that involves the main metabolism of nitrogen, which is the urea cycle. Let's take it off from there immediately. Essential amino acids are those amino acids that cannot be synthesized in the body and must therefore be obtained from dietary sources. But synthesis of protein requires the presence of every amino acid. If you're going to synthesize protein, you require the 20 amino acids. And if you cannot synthesize some of these amino acids, you need to get them from these sources. So some species, including humans, cannot produce all of them. So and those requirements must be met through dietary. And then so even humans at times can produce a few of them, but not in sufficient amount to meet the demand of the protein synthesis. So those extra demand has to be met through dietary needs. And this is a list of some essential and non-essential amino acid. Like I said, essential amino acid are those that you have to get from the diet, and these are all of them: arginine, histidine, isoleucine, leucine, lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, threonine, tryptophan, and valine. But that's the non-essential, those ones that we can synthesize. We can synthesize this one. Humans can synthesize these ones. Synthesize these ones. Alanine, aspargine, aspartate, cysteine, glutamate, glutamine, glycine, proline, serine, and tyrosine. And we saw a little bit of these ones, the synthesis of these ones in the first part of this lecture. Now, these are the ones that we have to get from the diet that we cannot synthesize at all. And now, there are a few check marks that if you look at the star, it means that the mammals can synthesize arginine, but most of them are used in urea cycle. And then histidine is essential only to the children. They cannot synthesize it, but in adult it is not essential because adult can actually synthesize that. So these are a few of those things you need to know about amino acid requirements in humans. So let's now typically go into amino acid metabolism. Now, the first step in amino acid metabolism involves what we talked about when we looked at the biosynthesis. It involves transamination by transaminase enzymes. And transamination simply is going to remove, particularly it starts from glutamate. Glutamate is going to lose its amino group and it will be transferred to another alpha-ketoglutarate to form an amino acid. And then the carbon skeleton or the keto acid will now be broken down. And then, or through deamination. Remember, deamination is that reductive deamination. So this deamination is usually done by dehydrogenesis using NAD, NAD or NADH, NAD plus or NADH. As because in this place is an oxido is a redox reaction, so it can either be transamination or deamination to remove that alpha keto group, just like we saw in the biosynthesis. However, if you now rip off those amino acid, you're going to be left with the alpha keto acid. What happens to the alpha keto acid? The fate of alpha keto acid are two types depending on the end product. Now, some of those amino acids that are broken down to pyruvate or oxaloacetate are said to be glucogenic. Glucogenic, they're broken down to pyruvate or oxaloacetate. In fact, this simply tells you that they have a link to glycolysis. Glucogenic have a link to glycolysis and gluconeogenesis. So because glucogenic amino acid, the carbon skeleton are degraded to pyruvate or oxaloacetate, both of which are used in the synthesis of glucose. That's why we call them the glucogenic amino acid. For the ketogenic amino acid, keto, they have a link to tricarboxylic acid cycle or citric acid cycle. So what's happening here is that the carbon skeleton, that means the alpha keto groups, is degraded to what? Acetyl-CoA or acetoacetyl-CoA, both of which are now used in the synthesis of ketone bodies. And you know, ketone bodies can be used as fuel in emergency situations in the body, particularly of the brain and of the heart and skeletal muscle. So these are the things that we need to remember, and then we need to remember that two classes of amino acid can be either be broken down into being a glucogenic amino acid or being a ketogenic amino acid. Like I said, after transamination, we're talking about the fate. In transamination, what is the fate? Of course, I'm going to just as a reminder in this, just to give you what this thing looks like again. So if this is the amino acid, I'm not going to want to, can I have enough space to make 1, 2, 3, 4, okay, 5. I got it. So this is H2, this is H2, yeah. So this is actually glutamate. So glutamate, of course, either through deamination or through transamination. I'm just going to make this in a short one. So either through transamination or through deamination. It's good when you rip off this damage, it's going to be losing whichever process that happens, it's going to be losing this NH4, and then it's going to become alpha ketoglutarate. So it's going to become, of course, if you remove this, you're going to have this. You're not going to have your CH2 here, you're going to have your CH2, you're going to have a CO. So this is, now remember, this is the glutamate, and this is the alpha ketoglutarate. Glutarate is usually the first thing that is usually synthesized, you know, in the catabolism of amino acid. Now, we've seen this already in the first part of this lecture. Now, we're going to be putting attention in something that is much newer that we're going to be talking about. Now, but before then, let's look at those classes. So, these are the classes of glucogenic, and ketogenic. Now, these ones are glucogenic. They include aspartate, asparagine, alanine, glycine, serine, threonine, cysteine, glutamate, glutamine, arginine, proline, histidine, valine, and methionine. Those of them that are ketogenic are only leucine and lysine, whereas some of them are both ketogenic and glucogenic, and they include isoleucine, phenylalanine, tryptophan, and tyrosine. So these are those two main classes of degradation products of amino acid. All right. So amino acid, we've looked at how the carbon skeleton is degraded. What about the ammonia that is released? Of course, ammonia that is released doesn't just exist as ammonia, because ammonia itself is a weak base which easily gains hydrogen to form ammonium, which is the conjugate, you know, which is the conjugate acid of ammonia. So ammonium is the conjugate acid of ammonia, which is the base. All right. So what happens? Ammonia is not stored in the body. Now, there are two things that happen. That amino group is used for two things, either for biosynthesis of nitrogen containing compound, which include the pyrenes, the pyrimidines particularly, or they are excreted. Now, and they're only used in synthesis when the need is important. Remember what I told you about their feedback. Only when the need is ultimately important, that is when they are used for biosynthesis. However, the excess of them is not stored in the body, and they need to be excreted as what? They need to be excreted. So they're excreted as part of nitrogen containing excess waste product, as either ammonium, like I showed you earlier, urea, this is structure of urea, which happens in the urea cycle, and uric acid. Uric acid, if you look at the uric acid, usually comes from the metabolism of the purines. And we're going to be talking about this at the third part of this lecture, when we look at the metabolism of purines themselves. We're going to see how we can synthesize uric acid from, or you can, is a breakdown product of those purines. So what we're going to be talking about now, we're going to be looking at the urea cycle, which is what we're going to be doing at the last part of this lecture. So we're going to talk about the synthesis of urea, which is called the urea cycle. So urea cycle, of course, is the pathway that leads to the excretion of waste product of nitrogen metabolism, especially those of the amino acid. That's what we're taking care of. Basically, urea cycle, we're taking care of excess amino acid that cannot be stored, like I said. The central pathway is a tetral pathway in nitrogen metabolism. And the nitrogen can enter this cycle comes from several sources. It can come from several sources, like we said, depending whether they are ketogenic or gluconeogenic. You find that because the citric acid cycle is anaplerotic, you know, it can supply a lot of things for this citric acid cycle, for urea cycle, I mean to say. So it has a link both this to the citric acid cycle and involved in the metabolism and also anabolism of amino acid. That's very important, like I said. Is involved in both their breakdown and synthesis. So the metabolic pathway starts by converting ammonium ion that is removed from deamination or transamination to urea. So what happens is that ammonium ion here react with carbon dioxide in the form of what? In the form of hydrogen carbonate ion to form carbamoyl phosphate. This is the first reaction. And this is taking place in the mitochondria. And then the chain continues from there, as we're going to see. So the first reaction is that ammonium reacts with this, ammonium ion reacts with carbonate, it is supposed to be CO2, but here it is as soluble in water as a carbonate ion. ATP is needed for to provide energy for this reaction to take place to form carbonyl phosphate. So this is the first intermediate formed in what urea cycle, and the enzyme that catalyzes first reaction is carbonyl phosphate synthetase. It is called a synthetase because it needs an energy for the hydrolysis of ATP for this. And it actually needs 2 moles of ATP for this thing to happen. So what is happening? If you look at this, this is getting to be a very, so what is remaining here? Now this looks like urea. What is remaining here is that it needs another amino group at this point. So this is called the carbonyl phosphate. And now, like I said, this is taking place in mitochondria. So this is the urea cycle. This is our urea cycle. What is happening in this urea cycle? Like I said, now, carbonyl phosphate is formed from here. That's what I said. It's formed from here and it continues in the reaction. Remember, all these things is happening in the mitochondria. This is happening in the mitochondria. This reaction is taking place in the mitochondria. Mitochondria or chondria. Not one. If it is single, it's mitochondria. Plural is mitochondria. Now, what happens? So, what it means is that this reaction now the first reaction is taking place in the mitochondria. So here, carbonyl phosphate is now combined with this compound, citrulline. Mitochondria. This is happening in mitochondria. Now, so carbonyl phosphate synthesized from this combines with what? Citrulline to carbonyl phosphate. I take that back, so I'm going to say it again. Carbonyl phosphate combines with ornithine to form citrulline. Citrulline, of course, becomes the second direct intermediate after the synthesis of carbonyl phosphate. Remember, this is a cycle. It continues running. So citrulline now is permeable to the walls, of the membranes of what? The mitochondria. So what does it do? Citrulline now goes through a citrulline transporter and enters the cytoplasm. So the rest of this part is the cytosol. Outside this place is the cytosol or the cytoplasm. Cytosol. Enters the cytosol and the reaction continues. In the cytosol, citrulline combines with aspartate. This needs hydrolysis of ATP to form aginosuccinate. Aginosuccinate is now broken down to fumarate and arginine. That's exactly what is happening here. That's what is arginine and succinate. So it's the two of them. That's what is happening here. So what happened here is that you break out the fumarate. If you break it from here, you form fumarate and the remaining part becomes arginine. Then arginine itself is now converted to what? Ornithine, releasing urea. That is the last reaction of that cycle, whereby arginine itself is now broken down, releasing urea and then releasing ornithine as well. And this now enters the kidney where it is now excreted as urine. So this is what we call the urea cycle. And having talked about this, we'll be coming to the end of this lecture. Once again, thank you for listening and do have a wonderful day ahead of you. Bye at this point.